Hello and welcome back to our unit on stress, coping, and health. Some researchers have posited that there are some folks who might be more hardy to stressors. Probably heard of the term resilience before. That comes up in your textbook. What's the difference between hardiness and resilience? I think they're often mixed up. Technically, resilience refers to error in the model. I predict that because of their low socioeconomic status, because of their addiction, because of their lack of family resources, because of XYZ ABC, these homeless youth on the street are going to have very poor long-term outcomes. Oh, look! Actually, some of them had good outcomes in spite of my model. The model failed. Maybe they had good luck. Maybe there was some resource they had. Maybe their friends, maybe their spirituality. I don't know what, but they made it. Those people were resilient. Hardy people are perhaps more likely to be resilient. Hardiness is kind of about taking the stressor, and the textbook defines hardiness as a set of attitudes where you see change as a challenge instead of a threat, where you are committed to your life and work. I think that gets back to values. And you believe you can control events. That gets the idea of an internal locus of control. People have an internal locus of control are supposed to think that, you know, they have agency and feel like they can control outcomes, whereas people with an external locus of control would put things down to fate and feel like they have less control. And intro type textbooks like to suggest that everyone should have an internal locus of control because it's correlated with better things, outcomes. I'm going to put my critical thinking hat on right now. They are looking at hardiness as a set of attitudes where you do three things. They're kind of putting it down to perception. Like, oh, you could be an optimist or a pessimist. The glass is half full or the glass is half empty. According to the transactional model of stress, your appraisal as of a stressor as a challenge or a threat is ultimately based on your resources. Okay? If the stressful stimulus is something that would overwhelm your coping resources, then you see it as a threat. And part of that is like perception, and then part of it might be accurate. You might know that these are your resources and that is what is required to cope and be like, ah. Some of that might be accurate. And then maybe some of that's a bad attitude. If you see challenge as, if you see that the stressor is a challenge, what that means is that you believe you have the resources, right, within you or within your community and your friends that you're going to get through this. And maybe some of that is attitude. And then I would say, well, what if some of that is actual resources, right? What if people with higher socioeconomic status are more likely to have an attitude where they see the stressor as a challenge than a threat because they actually have more resources to cope, and that's true. I think about that. The belief that you can control events. The textbook is seeing this as a perception thing, right? That all things being equal, some people feel like they can control events and they feel like they have agency and some people don't. And my counter to that would say, well, how much of that is perception and how much of that is attributable to real differences in something like socioeconomic status? Class is ultimately about agency and power. Higher class people have more resources and more power to do what they want, right, than lower class people who have less resources and less power. So somebody's belief that they can control events, you know, is going to be partly about things like, I don't know, self-esteem and self-concept. And then what if some of it is actually true? So I would want to know that these this research somehow, you know, controlled for SES. And I don't know if it did, because I'm reading this in a textbook, which is a tertiary source, and I'm not going back to check the primary sources to say, okay, did they do this and did they do that? So I'm relaying that information and also saying, hey, keep in mind that there could be confounds here. And the textbook says this this hardiness variable is associated with less vulnerability to anxiety. It makes sense because you feel like you can control things and you have the resources to deal with them, and more calm reactions to stress. But what I would want to know is how much of this is about perception and how much of that perception is like true. How much is this really about attitude? The text teaches us that optimistic people are more productive, focused, and handle frustration better. And to some extent, there is like an attitude variable, right? Where their example here is if some people see this glass as sort of half empty and some people see it as half full. Like you have some agency to catastrophize and awfulize and freak out that probably doesn't help you deal. And you have some agency also to think about opportunities and growth and, you know, how you can make lemonade out of this. There is an observation that people who are religious seem to have higher well-being and cope with stress a little better. And there are many potential reasons for that. But in a kind of scientific materialist discipline, we can't say, oh, it's because they believe in God and they have a relationship with God and God is actually helping them. So we look for these materialistic explanations. So maybe it could be because many religions prohibit behaviors that would cause stress to you. So Muslims, if they're adhering to their religion, don't drink alcohol. I have never met a person in my history of meeting people who are struggling that has said to me, you know, my life is falling apart because I don't drink alcohol. I have never met anyone, right, bring not drinking up as a problem, right? It's not drinking is basically risk-free and benefits all the way. There's alcohol use causes a lot of accidents. It's easy to spiral into a dependency, and then you end up having all kinds of problems with the relationships and with work. A friend of mine passed away last year due to what I believe is alcoholism. I think the primary cause of death was like a heart attack, but I saw her going down that spiral over the years, and you know, if only she had not drunk. So maybe that's one reason why. Other things that are prohibited according to different religions are, say, like risky sex. What else? Seventh-day Adventist or vegetarian? They have, you know, when there's health risks associated with high meat consumption. So maybe that's one thing. If you are a member of an organized religion, it also provides you with a community. So whether it's a mosque or a church or a temple, you have somewhere to go every week or more often than that where you belong. And there's a community that's kind of like an extended family where people care about you across your whole life course, lifespan. They help you with transitions, right? They're there for you when something good happens to celebrate. They're there for you to celebrate major life milestones like coming of age, having a child. And they, you know, are there to, at the end of life, right there, it provides a lot of social support. And we know that social support itself is a protective factor, right? It provides relationships. We know that relationships are a key predictor of well-being, probably one of the most important ones. And then maybe it gives people that feeling of meaning and purpose. It gives them a framework within which they can interpret things. Maybe they don't catastrophize small things as much if they kind of believe in some kind of a higher purpose or power or plan. Okay. So maybe it gives them more positive appraisals of stressful situations. Okay, so maybe it helps people cope. And I have a comment in the chat from Liam. People who are religious often believe that everything happens for a reason. Yeah, and that gives you a sense of control, right? One of the most stressful things is the idea that you have no control. But maybe if you had no control, but you thought that some other being like God is actually controlling all of this, and you just have to trust him, maybe that could be relieving as a thought. They may believe that all the bad things in their life are God's plan and everything will be okay in the end. Sure, sounds reasonable to me. Any other thoughts on this? I will say that most like religious people would probably not take this perspective and would take the perspective that their relationship with God is real and meaningful and beneficial in their lives actively. Without it being because of these other things, right? Like diet or social support. Liam says, religion exists to explain things we don't understand. Right, so the ancients often had gods who explained nature, like storms and such things. Yeah, so it helps us understand why bad things happen, have a bit more of a sense of control. Now, it is possible, but extremely difficult, to try to empirically test religious ideas. There have been attempts to see if intercessory prayer works. So let's say that there's sick people in the hospital. Will they get better faster if they are prayed for? That kind of research has been done. And it's still difficult to do, because let's say that you wanted to test that. Right? You want to see, let's say you could have a control group where they're not being prayed for, they're just being talked about. Or the control group is doing something else. So you can do that study, but then who are you going to get to do the praying, and what prayers are they going to say, right? Are they going to be Catholic monks doing Catholic prayers, or should they be, Hindus doing Hindu prayers, or should they be, Buddhists doing Buddhist prayers, like which, or should it be a combination of all of them, right? But you can see how it gets sticky to test something like that. The research that I have seen when I perused Google Scholar on intercessory prayer generally suggests that it doesn't work. But there is a big effect. There's an effect if people know that they're being prayed for. And it can actually make things worse if they know they're being prayed for. And maybe that's because they might want to get more attention by being more sick. So I don't know. Grace says, I feel like prayer is a form of manifestation of laws of attraction. Like if you wake up in the mindset of today is going to suck, have a bad day, whereas approaching with a positive mindset, you're more likely to see the good in the day and enjoy it more. I agree. And in fact, every morning from 8:45 to 9, I pray and then I take on my day. Now, I left this slide from the textbook publisher as is, and I added a big question mark to be like, let's think critically about this. So the textbook says that some ways of reacting to stress are counterproductive. It says suppression of negative emotions does not work. That is a bad coping strategy, right? Ruminating is a bad strategy, and women do it more often, and maybe that's why they're more depressed and anxious. And I sort of stopped in my track seeing this, because I'm convinced that there's no behavior alone, no state trait or behavior alone that's good or bad without context. That the assessment that it was good or bad is really an assessment that it was adaptive or maladaptive, and that relies on some context, and that relies on some goal. So what's the goal? It's to deal with the stressor or at least not be destroyed by it. So what about suppression of negative emotions? They're suggesting that, oh, you know, no, that doesn't work because then you haven't dealt with it. But do you need to deal with it? And I'll give you an example. I have a colleague. She's a professor. She's Indigenous. And she has, a history of trauma, right, in the foster care system. She watched her brother be killed. And one time she went to see a psychologist because it was on her job, gives you these benefits, right? You get maybe you get $1,000 towards seeing a psychologist. And she went to see a psychologist who wanted to like drag all this stuff up. And my colleague was expressing her frustration with this. She was like, no, you know, I'm not thinking about it. I'm focused on my work and I'm happy. Like, why did she need to drag all that up and process those emotions? I mean, that would have been good for the psychologist. It would have gotten the psychologist many billable hours, but I don't know if it would have helped my colleague, right? Because the past was in the past. She suppressed it, and she is moving on, and she's very successful professionally, and she seems like a happy person. Why should she go do that? And here again, ruminating. And there's a connection with depression. There is evidence that people who are prone to depression or people who are depressed actually have better analytical skills. And they're analyzing this problem and they're playing it over and over in their head. And sometimes things keep coming back to you like that. If you haven't worked through them, there's something you need to figure out, get to the bottom of. And you know, maybe if you're not seeing it and you're just thinking about it on your own and just repeating that, yeah, I could see how that's maladaptive. But, you know, what if you go and talk about it? What if you keep thinking about it? What if you think about it from a different perspective and you finally get that aha moment that allows you to understand and move on because you're that analytical kind of person that needs to understand? So I don't like just knocking rumination either. Like, maybe if you're ruminating about something, it's really important to you and understanding it is important to you. And maybe somebody could help you understand a little better, but maybe you need to understand. So those are my sort of objections to the way the textbook is framing things. I find that in psychology, they get caught up in these analyzing, summarizing, all these little studies that say, hey, this thing like ruminating is associated with some bad thing in this sample, in this particular questionnaire we did. But it's in such a limited context. And then they summarize these studies that are often like correlational and that are often about people in similar contexts. And I feel like if I step back and try to say, look at larger contexts, things start falling apart. Grace has a comment about suppression. I feel like suppression often ends up with a buildup of negative emotions that end up being displaced, such as someone who hasn't fully either processed their emotions of grief might be more agitated towards others or get mad about other things that aren't related to their grief, but their grief manifests into anger. That anger is amplified because they're having a hard time processing their emotions. I agree. That's displacement is, that's one of the Freudian defense mechanisms, right? But we know that Freud is silly, but I think he still did some good work on defense mechanisms. So, yeah, suppression could be maladaptive if, right? It's conditional if it's coming out in this, it's coming out sideways in this bad way. But in the case of my colleague, it's not coming out sideways. It's working for her. So there's the state trader behavior. Ruminating or suppressing or journaling or whatever it is. And then there's the outcome, and it's good or bad, it's maladaptive or adaptive based on the outcome, not based on the state trader behavior itself in isolation. And I love journaling. I'm a big journaler, and my partner hates it. Like, he thinks I'm doing that all the time and it doesn't work. I think it does, or I like it. Anyway, so what's my take-home point is, yeah, as you're reading and learning this and you're answering these Revell quiz questions that are written by the textbook publishers, you're memorizing it, please still keep your critical capacity. On to the immune system. So in our last lecture, I explained how the stress response, that fight or flight response, is associated with your, the activation was actually a result of the activation of your sympathetic nervous system. Okay, so your nervous system has two divisions, autonomic, it's kind of the automatic stuff, and somatic, which controls like voluntary movements. And under the autonomic nervous system, there's another two branches, sympathetic and parasympathetic. And the sympathetic nervous system is the one that gets you ready to fight the tiger or run away, right? It increases your heart rate and your blood pressure, your breathing rate, your pupils dilate, right? It's so you're ready to fight. And then once you've escaped the stressor, you can, your parasympathetic system kicks in, and then you can calm down, and then we can divert that energy that was previously diverted to, let's say, sending blood to your muscles, pumping up your heart to deal with the stressor. You know, now it can go back to like the digestive system and the sexual response system and the immune system. Okay. The immune system is one of those like energy resource heavy systems that gets shut down during your sympathetic response. And this can be a problem if you have a lot of sympathetic activation in the long term, okay? Because suppressing your immune system means that you are going to be more likely to get sick, okay? And you're gonna have a harder time fighting off illnesses when you do get sick. By the way, when I make up psychology exams, all this biological stuff, I'm like, that's biology, and I don't test it. I'm not going to be like phagocytes and lymphocytes and AIDS. Like, that's not psychology. There is a connection between your psychology, right? Between your psyche, between your subjective experience, your attitudes, your behaviors, all that psychology stuff. There's a connection between that and your nervous system and your immune system and your endocrine system. Obviously, that's the take-home point. However, the word, I mocked this on social media, psychoneuroimmunology, and sometimes they call it psychoneuroendocrinoimmunology, is like a very impressive, large word that explains a pretty simple concept. And I've never come across it again after intro psych. I learned this word when I was an intro psych student. And then, you know, I went on to finish a psych degree. I went on to grad studies in epidemiology and in psychology. And never have I ever seen a section of like CPA or CSBBCS that's like, we are the psychoneuroendocrinoimmunologists. I've never met somebody that said they did that or were one of those. So my cynical idea is that this just is supposed to impress you, but it is still true that there's a connection between these different systems, right? Obviously, you're one whole organism. Question from Annabelle. Why does caring for somebody with Alzheimer's disease lower your ability to heal? Well, let me jump back to that slide. Good question. What do you think?
I think to help with Annabella's question, because my dad actually has Alzheimer's, I think the person has a lower chance to heal is because their mind, memories are basically scattered all over the place. Their memories are not basically, so let's say they probably more flashback.
No, Fassian, it's why does caring for somebody? It's the carer. It's you.
Oh, okay. Someone with Alzheimer's ability to heal. That's a really good question.
So it's the caregivers of people with Alzheimer's disease, and I suspect this would generalize to caregiving for other people with really difficult situations.
Situations, yeah.
So it's not, this is probably not Alzheimer's specific. Why are we noticing that these caregivers, right, have a poor ability to heal some wound? And I think Phoenix has it, right? It's a stressful role. Imagine you are, I mean, this may very well be your situation. Maybe you're a student, you have a job, maybe you have a partner, maybe you have kids. And let's say you're also taking care of a parent with dementia or Alzheimer's, right? Like that is stressful. Like that can kind of turn your life upside down. You have to rearrange everything around that. Like most people I know who deal with this situation need help, right? They need to have other people come into the home. Sometimes they just can't do it on their own, and the person ends up in a residential home. Right, like let's say they have falls, they get lost, they forget, they leave the stove on. So the caregiver's stress is heightened, right? Compared to like not dealing with that, compared to having a parent who could help you, right? And babysit for you and help you get groceries. Now you have one that you have to take care of. It increases stress in the caregiver. And then what does stress do to the immune system? When you're in that sympathetic state all the time, right? You're in the resistance mode, and then what happens, right? It suppresses your immune system, it wears you down. And then that's why they, if they're injured themselves, they have a slower ability, impaired ability to heal. Does that make sense? Yeah, okay. There was a belief at one time that, now I'm going to phrase this differently. At different times in history, there've been illnesses that doctors can't explain. And they tend to put that down to psychological stuff, right? It's in your head. And maybe it's because you're neurotic, and maybe it's because you're stressed. And there was a time that people believed that peptic ulcers were caused by stress. And that belief is so common that I've even heard it. Like, oh, you know, don't stress so much, you'll give yourself an ulcer. But it has subsequently been discovered that peptic ulcers are actually because of a bacteria, Helicobacter pylori. That said, if you do have a virus, if you do have a bacteria, you do have an infection, being stressed is not going to help you heal, as we know from that example with the caregivers of the Alzheimer's patient. I think I've mentioned to you guys before that I'm really like working very hard right now, 12-hour days through the weekends. Like there was a lecture, I was just like so tired, I didn't know how I was gonna get through it. And right now, for the first time in my life, I have like an ear infection and I can't hear out of one ear, and I want it to heal and go away, but it's probably not going to do that until I can take a break and sleep it off a bit. Fasian has a question. What about people who have chronic disease? Do stress affect their immune system in a way that may make more illnesses? Absolutely. So it is stressful to have a chronic illness, right? It is stressful to have, say, type 1 diabetes because you have to deal with it all the time. Things come up, things happen. Yeah, you know, you get a DKA. It's stressful to have the illness. It's also stressful to navigate life with the illness, right? Maybe you need accommodations, you're not getting them, maybe you're dealing with stigma. And then, yeah, all of that makes it harder to deal with the illness. I'm type 1 diabetic, and when I'm stressed, my blood sugars are high. Right? I see that in my glucose readings. So absolutely, it does complicate things and make things worse. That said, it doesn't follow that if you have some kind of an illness, that relaxation and positive thinking and having hope is going to cure it. So if you have anxiety, relaxation and positive thinking and optimism and hope will do wonders for you. However, let's say that your issue is stage 4 cervical cancer. That is not anxiety, the psychological in your head thing. Stage 4 cervical cancer is a very biological thing, right? Where the cancer is following some kind of a genetic blueprint and all the hope in the world isn't going to stop it. Does that make sense? There are problems that are more psychological and there are problems that are more biological. And hope and stress and such have probably a bigger impact on the psychological ones. But it's also true that any illness is going to be worse if you throw stress on top of it. And if you throw, like, negative attitudes, etc., on top of it, because you'll have poor well-being. Maybe you don't take such good care of yourself. As you know, that sympathetic stress response is hard on your heart because it increases your heartbeat and your blood pressure, okay? And so over time, we do see effects of stress on the heart, particularly with heart disease. Heart disease is actually the leading cause of death in the United States. I think it's the second one in Canada. Different animals have different kind of vulnerabilities. If you have an old cat, you know that kidney disease is like the thing with old cats. Cats have like weaker kidneys and they give out first. With humans, it's the heart. Okay. And so it's important to, if you can, try to eat heart healthy, try to exercise, and reduce stress. But that is like the way that most of us are going to go. So I just made fun of psychoneuroendocrinology, but I am nevertheless acknowledging, welcoming of the biopsychosocial perspective on illness. So if you have an illness like cancer, there's a biological side to that there, and biological treatments as well. Like, there's a social side to that. Now, how are you navigating life? How are your relationships? What are the structures and systems you're dealing with? And how are they helping or harming you? And then there's a psychological factor as well, right? How are you coping? How are you thinking about this? What is your well-being? Okay, all those things are important. The textbooks makes this statement, or the textbook publisher slides make this statement. Disorders are the product of biological, psychological, and social factors. I think that's misleading. So a disorder is like any illness, any mental illness. And I would say that any mental illness could be affected by these factors, but it's not in the same way or in the same amount. If you contract AIDS, that would be the product of a biological factor that is the virus, right? You can't just like be near somebody who has AIDS and catch it by looking at them or thinking about them or socializing with them. Okay, so I wouldn't agree that they're caused by all these three things. They're all caused by all these three things and to the same extent. That doesn't make sense to me. But I think that there are biological, psychological, and social considerations to all diseases. There are some disorders that are probably almost entirely social. I'll give you the example of eating disorders. There's huge cultural differences in eating disorders. Here in the West, you have girls kind of starving themselves to be thin, to be beautiful. That's what, you know, the ads from the fashion houses are showing. In Mauritania, girls are taking medication and suffering and harming themselves in order to be fat, because that's the beauty ideal in some parts of sub-Saharan Africa. Okay, that is very, very, eating disorders are very cultural. They're very much about like what other people think of you and social standing. Not all of them. Like, I don't think that applies to, say, binge eating disorder, where people may get a sense of comfort from the food. But a lot of the ones in the West that are about being thin have a huge social factor. And I would say that could be socially caused. But I would never agree that schizophrenia is socially caused, or the manic depression. Bipolar disorder. That is highly, highly heritable. Right? Autism isn't caused by social factors or upbringing. People are born with it. People are born with ADHD or autism or neurodivergences, but their social experience hugely matters, right? Their training hugely matters. Coaching hugely matters. How they're treated in society, whether they are seen as badly behaved or whether they're included, have huge or huge factors in outcomes. So there's something I don't like about the way this is phrased, if that makes sense. I see a comment from Annabelle. I'm curious on what's the biological reason that stress lowers the chances to get better, because it suppresses your immune system. Because your immune system, say it burns a lot of calories. And when your body goes into that sympathetic activation profile, one of its settings, imagine it's a computer program, is to suppress the immune system and the digestive system. That's why you want to throw up. That's why you want to poop when you're stressed. That's why people sometimes pee in their pants. Okay. And the sexual response system. When you're really stressed, you're not thinking about sex. It is adaptive for you, your body, to direct resources away from those energy intensive systems toward dealing with the life-threatening stressor, which historically is a lion or a tiger or a bear. But now we are constantly and chronically provoking that system to non-life-threatening stressors like midterms and quizzes and romantic rejections, okay? So what it adapted to do is kind of now misaligned with what it's being provoked for. And that's why we need to use a lot of psychological, a lot of whatever it is, biological strategies to calm ourselves down, because we're probably overreacting to stress chronically. But Annabelle, there would be a biological answer to your question that some biologists would be able to answer that would say, okay, well, when this hormone is released, that, you know, lymphocyte isn't produced as much, but I'm not a biologist, so I can't really explain it in that pharmacological, in that kind of a way. Caitlin says, maybe saying that there's a biopsychosocial aspect to every disorder would be more accurate. I agree that. Thank you. Because when you have a disorder, you not only have to navigate the disorder, but also how you function and how others perceive you, because that's sort of beautiful. I agree. Well put. You should write textbook slides, Kayla. As I've mentioned, there is an association between stress and the development of heart disease. Remember that sympathetic stress response, really, it's hard on your heart. Okay, if that happens a few times, definitely adaptive, helps you escape from a tiger. But now think about like constantly provoking that every day. What's that going to do? It's going to put a lot of strain on your heart. You've probably heard about like type A and type B personalities before. That happened because some cardiologists noticed that they looked at wear patterns on the chairs in the office. And I can't remember if it was two cardiologists or one cardiologist that noticed this, but the chairs where these heart patients sat in had particular wear patterns that suggested that they were sitting kind of tensely. And they noticed that these people who were more likely to have heart disease had particular personality traits. They seemed to be more competitive, more driven, intense, ambitious, more angry and hostile. And basically, when I was reading that description, I'm thinking about the HEXCO personality, which is our best personality model. I'm thinking, yeah, disagreeable, conscientious. Then, you know, type A personality isn't really a personality, it's a cluster of traits. And researchers have asked, okay, well, which ones? Is it the ambition that's associated with the heart disease, right? Is it the drivenness? Is it their sort of hostility or their cynicism? And it seemed like the one that really matters is hostility. I'm thinking back to the Hexaco again, and remember that anger is the key emotion for dominance. And I can imagine that people who are striving for dominance are probably, you know, getting angry more often and asserting themselves angrily more often, and wear you down over time. So we can increase our well-being and reduce possible negative outcomes by trying to live a healthy lifestyle. And that includes trying to reduce stress. There is a discipline of psychology called health psychology that uses psychology to try to help people be healthier. These are often clinical. I think they're always, in fact, clinical psychologists. So it's like a subdiscipline of clinical psychology. Clinical psychologists work in a medical model of mental illness, and they often work in hospital systems as well. So I know if any of you guys have chronic illnesses, maybe you're on the young side to have them, but if you're a person with diabetes, if you're a person with some physical condition, kidney condition, there's probably a clinic that you go to, right? Like the kidney clinic or the diabetes clinic. And there's a team of people in that clinic. And there's like, let's say it's diabetes, there's the endocrinologist, there's a diabetes nurse, there's the dietitian. And then there's the health psychologist, right? And the health psychologist helps with things like complying with medical regimens, trying to, and compliance is challenging. Like most people don't comply with what their family doctor says. So you can see this would be a big issue in chronic illnesses. So they help with things like compliance, with navigating the social landscape. They help with trying to reduce unhealthy behaviors. So if somebody has a kidney condition, you really don't want them to be smoking. So you might want to help them like quit smoking as well. What else? Health behaviors can be really challenging in the context of chronic illness. Kidney disease has one of the most restrictive diets ever. There's so many things that people with kidney conditions can't eat because they have to watch their potassium and their phosphorus and their sodium and their this and their that. And they also have to watch their fluid levels to the point that even if it's hot and they're thirsty, sometimes they can't drink because that would mess up their fluid levels. And now imagine having that condition and navigating a world where people are always offering you food, where there's like a birthday party at work and you feel rude if you don't eat the thing or drink the thing. There's a wedding and a banquet and you're tempted by all this food and people are like, here, have this dip. And maybe, you know, you're having cravings and how are you going to stand up to all that? How are you going to resist that? And so there are a lot of different sort of strategies, you know, even ways of saying no, like that you could coach a person on. Annabelle says, isn't it a bit closed-minded that most doctors don't believe in chronic illnesses? Oh, doctors know that there are chronic conditions. So what's a chronic condition? I've been going with diabetes. That's a chronic illness. Cancer is kind of a chronic illness. It's not like you're like, here, here's a pill that cures your cancer. Now it's not chronic. So there are tons of chronic illnesses out there. And you said they kind of tell you to suck it up because nothing shows up on the x-ray in your pain. Okay, I think you're talking about something different here. There are some illnesses, some kinds of malaise that there isn't a biological explanation for. And sometimes they're called psychosomatic disorders because we assume that it's in somebody's head. So an example of that is like fibromyalgia. There's a lot of people that don't really believe that fibromyalgia is like real. It's in your head. It's psychosomatic. And then there's people who passionately believe that there's a biological condition. So fibromyalgia, chronic pain disorder, there's a few like that that are arguably psychosomatic, but then maybe somehow some years down the road, we'll discover that actually, you know, here's this virus that we never knew about that's causing the fibromyalgia. I mean, that sort of happened with the ulcers thing, right? That was thought to be a psychological issue, and then they found out it was caused by a bacteria. Can that be closed-minded? Absolutely. Yeah, I think it is, actually. Phoenix says, they're also invisible chronic disorders, which are hard to spot and diagnose, and subsequently patients are brushed off regularly. Yeah, absolutely agree. And, you know, that can even happen with people who have really serious conditions, right? They can get brushed off. And that actually happened to me. Happened to me and some other people I know with type 1 diabetes, which is a very serious chronic condition where it's like you die if you don't treat it, but we're not diagnosed until they were basically dying because, you know, doctors were brushing off their parents, saying, oh, you know, it's tummy ache, they're trying to stay home from school. Bedwetting is because of anxiety, and like prescribing them pills to stop the bedwetting and just like not taking it seriously. So that happens even with like known to be serious conditions. So things that health psychologists would want you to do are like stopping smoking, exercising regularly, you know, eating your vegetables, you know, curbing alcohol consumption. You might be surprised to know that there are very few people in our population that do all those things, right? If you wanted to find somebody that exercised every day and that was eating 5 servings of vegetables and not smoking and, you know, not drinking more than the recommended amounts, and was it a healthy weight, you would have a very hard time finding that person, right? Because most of us are sedentary. Most of us are eating poor diets. Most of us are, you know, drinking or smoking or some such. Fazian says, I've noticed an increase in young people are being diagnosed with MG, myasthenia gravis, more recently. Can't think to wonder if their bodies are just tired from the social aspects of life where you have to work hard to get things correct or right in their life. And that leads to stress. What's my input on that? I've never heard of this before. Like, after class, I'm going to Google this. But thank you for bringing it up. I don't know what that condition is. So I can't help you now. I am ignorant. But it sounds like you have a hypothesis. So smoking is something that your doctor is probably against. Though my uncle is a doctor who smokes. And, you know, a lot of smokers want to quit, and it's really hard to quit. It's one of the hardest habits to kick ever. But every time somebody tries and fails, they're actually more likely to succeed the next time. So it makes sense to keep trying. And one thing that surprises me about smoking cessation is that you'd think that you could just give them nicotine, like just give them a nicotine patch, done. No. People don't even get addicted to vaping. When I was a student at Dalhousie, there was a prof who studied this. He couldn't get people addicted to vaping. There's something about the burning tobacco. So it's kind of more about more than the nicotine itself. I mean, there's nicotine gum, but you don't have like kids being like, oh, let's go do some nicotine gum. Alcohol is a big part of our culture. You know, people want to relax. Let's go have beers together. Let's have a glass of wine with this meal. Let's toast with champagne. A lot of people don't feel like they can go out dancing until they've gotten sloshed. Right? I love dancing, but I need to go to bed on time because I need to wake up in the morning. And it's so hard to find places to dance at like a reasonable hour because there's this cultural thing where people need to go and get drunk. And they're only that drunk by like 11 o'clock, which is the dancing start. It's very frustrating for me. Anyway, there is no recommended healthy amount of alcohol. Right? I've never met anyone who had a problem because they weren't drinking. And there's some controversy about whether like a small amount of alcohol is good, like, you know, a glass of wine with dinner every night. Like, could there be some benefits to that? And it's controversial. I can't really answer for sure. Could be other things like socioeconomic status, because if you're sipping wine with dinner, you're probably wealthier. It could be about other things that are in the wine, like resveratrol, like red wine's full of, say, antioxidants. Maybe it's about that. What we do know is that the more you drink, right, let's say you take it up from 1 unit to 2 units, from 2 to 3, from 3 to 4, the more likely you are to have accidents, the more likely you are to have chronic health problems, the more likely you are to develop cancer. So my friend who has an alcohol use disorder didn't die from being drunk, right? She didn't die from drinking, from an accident. She didn't die from cirrhosis. She died of hardened arteries. So it messes with a lot of systems. Doctors don't even really know how hangovers work. Ethanol alcohol is a tiny little molecule, and it can gum up so many different systems. Liam says, from what I've heard, small amounts of wine are good for you, but only because of the nutrients in the fruit. I honestly enjoy wine, so But I do my, so I do drink. If I was having dinner, yeah, I'd for sure be having a glass of wine with that. But I have to remind myself, no, there's no second glass of wine, because if you have two, then if you have three, you know, can end up with problems. We are at 12:20, and I'll come back to talk about weight next day. I'm going to stop the recording so that we can chat more if you have any questions.